40% of our agriculture is
la presentación que le hacemos, ¿no?
Sí. Primero nos sentamos aquí, ¿no? Sí, mamá. Sí, porque no sé cómo sentarme con mis primos.
Okay. Welcome to this event on low emission food exports based on an agro landscape approach, where we're going to be talking about some examples from the countries of Costa Rica and Paraguay. But before starting, I really wanted to thank the Global Agenda on Sustainable Livestock for the support in making possible this space for the agriculture sector of the Americas to have a greater voice here at the COP27. For the hemisphere and all the actors across the agricultural value chain. So to start the event, we have the president of the Global Agenda on Sustainable Livestock, Shirley Tarawali, that is joining us. And I will pass to her for a few opening brief remarks. Shirley.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Kelly, excellencies. Ministers of Environment, Costa Rica, Minister of Agriculture, Paraguay, other excellences here present, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. As you heard, I'm Shirley Tarawali. I'm chair of the Global Agenda for Sustainable Livestock. I'm also Assistant Director General at ILRI, the International Livestock Research Institute, based in Kenya. And that's where I'm speaking to you from. So I must firstly send sincere apologies that I cannot be with you in person. However, I was really pleased to learn that I could join virtually because this is such an important topic and one that it's so good to have these very real, practical examples for, and one that a sustainable livestock sector must play a critical role in. Thank you to IECA, the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation on Agriculture, for this opportunity as well. The Global Agenda for Sustainable Livestock is a multi-stakeholder partnership that brings together all typologies of livestock sector stakeholders, from smallholders to commercial and everything in between. It brings together different organizations, NGOs, governments, academia, public and private sector, civil society, and multilateral organizations. It aims to assemble evidence, foster dialogue and consensus around livestock-related issues, to support practice and policy change towards sustainable livestock solutions that contribute to development ambitions. So it's a good example of how parties work together to build collaborative agreements that improve the sustainability and performance of this important agricultural sector. The countries we'll focus on today, Costa Rica and Paraguay, have been public sector members of the Global Agenda for Sustainable Livestock since 2016 and are well recognized for constant attention and action towards greater livestock sector sustainability. We know for livestock, sustainability must be addressed across multiple domains: food security and nutrition, livelihoods and economic growth, animal health, animal welfare, and climate action, all the while leaving no one behind. So it's really fantastic that Costa Rica and Paraguay will today share their experience and the progress they've made towards these real life solutions that connect agricultural food exports with consumer markets, farmers and family incomes, as well as the agricultural landscapes on which they depend and which must be so carefully stewarded. In both these countries, their recognition of their dependence on natural capital, and for both, as I believe we'll hear, significant forest cover to sustain agricultural food production and thus export earnings, have led to these innovative policies and approaches that we're going to hear about. It's really great to have this opportunity to hear about such practical examples that are recognizing and managing what at times can be complex trade-offs between profit, export earnings, environment, agroecosystems, and livelihoods. And of course, for sustainable livestock and for the multi-stakeholder processes that the Global Agenda for Sustainable Livestock offers, we're really pleased to have both countries as members and to have them setting such good examples. I really wish you a very successful event. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Shirley, for those words and for the leadership that GASL is showing in helping to coordinate the different actors to move towards more sustainable livestock systems around the world. So we have a real treat today. We have two ministers here, and we are going to present through the cases of Costa Rica and Paraguay, two very different national experiences in working to develop agricultural public policies that incorporate climate action, both from the resilience and mitigation standpoints, along with agricultural productivity in the context of different landscapes and national circumstances, but with a long-term vision. We know that public policies to support sustainable development that incorporate climate action are really a major challenge and a massive undertaking, because they have to undertake just what Shirley was mentioning, really understanding the trade-offs and take into account the economic, social, and environmental dimensions, understand where there's synergies, understand the goals of communities, the goals at the broader landscape level of the different regions of the countries, and also look across the global trends, taking into account the main climate threats, what are the risks and viable adaptation options, what are the different, which are different for each community, for each subsector, and for different, each part of the agricultural value chain. They also that need that identification and cost benefit of the different options. What are the co-benefits in terms of productivity, water quality, biodiversity, soil health? How do we manage among the multiple goals and the expectations that exist for the agricultural sector? And then how do you identify the finance that you need to really make these policy instruments work and operationalize them in the field? And how do you do this in a participatory manner that responds to different stakeholders? So these, I'm very excited to have with us ministers from each of these countries to show us these illustrative cases that contain many useful lessons learned for other countries. And so without further ado, I am going to pass the microphone to the Minister of Agriculture from Paraguay, Santiago Bertoni, to tell us a little bit about their experiences working on this issue.
Thank you very much, Kelly. First of all, I want to thank the invitation to be here and the opportunity to show our livestock producing system in Paraguay. In Paraguay, the livestock, the meat products are the second largest product that and it has a very important role in the economic sector. Paraguay is a small country, about 7 million people, and we have about 15 million cows in the herds in Paraguay. And then we need to produce and export, because the internal consumption is less than 20%. Of the old production, then we have to export around 80% of all the meat product that the country produces. Paraguay is the agricultural sector, the livestock and the agricultural sector, an important main sector, economic sector in my country, and they contribute about the 40% of the GDP and more than 70% of all the products that Paraguay exports for all around the country, the world. There we can show how we increase the production of the main export product, that is the soybean in Paraguay, using the crop rotation, about soybean, corn, and wheat. In Paraguay, we can do 2.5 crop yearly. And we can show there how we increase it. The total production is about 10 million tons yearly. The past years, we had the drought hit very, very hard to the production, but now we are increasing the production again. Next, please. Now, there is the export of meat of Paraguay since 2009 to 2021. Now we export almost in meat about 300 tons of meat, meat products, meat, hay, milk. And it represents more than 2,000 millions of dollars yearly. It's the second product. First, the soybean, and then we had the meat and the main important product that Paraguay exports. Second, next, please. Paraguay has almost the 50% of all that his territory, like the Spanish soap. In the Chaco region, there are more than about 13 million hectares, and in the Oriental Eastern region, we had 2 million and a half hectares of forest that it represents about 40% of the whole Paraguayan territory, like forest. And then with the other types of landscape, probably we reach the 50% of the territory that like and the with a national park. We had a lot of territory to increase our production. What we are now focusing and to increase the productivity also to increase the production per hectare. Next, please. The contribution in Paraguay is very low. That is the reason because we are most focused in adaptation than the mitigation, because we, the emission is 0.09% of all the greenhouse emission globally. That's the reason, because Paraguay is focusing adaptation. Adaptation is our national priority. Our target on our NDC is to reduce in 20% to 2030. National inclusions include adaptation and mitigation to the mitigation of climate change. Now we can show Paraguay 99% of all the agricultural is under conservation system, just crop rotation, zero tillage, and the use of biotechnological products like new breeding technique, the OGMs, and precision breeding products. Next, please. Now we can show all the increase of the hectares in Paraguay under conservation system, zero tillage, and this allow us to increase the production, the yield in 2 tons hectares in the last 10 years. That is without increasing the frontier of the agriculture in Paraguay. In the eastern region, it's forbidden to do deforestation. Just in the Chaco region, that is the second largest forest in America, the Amazonian forest. And the deforestation is what you can do under certain conditions, and the grower has to less about 43% of the whole territory like forest. Next, please. Now we are working with the National Wildlife Federation to join all the database we have in Paraguay, then to link the deforestation with the production, with the then we can certificate that the count that the hive producing in this farm is not had a relation with the deforestation. That is because we want to continue to export to Europe, to other markets, and probably in the next year, we want to begin to export meat to the United States. Paraguay had a lot of sustainable initiatives regarding production. Then they had early system, early warning system in climate risk to warning our growers about the climate problem. And there is a project to increase the production, everything related in the environmental and social criteria. Also a program to focus in a small farmer to increase the area of restoration and conservation agriculture with this focusing in the soils management. And the project with the National Forest Federation, that is to link the Infona with the Minister of Agriculture, the Institute of Forestry, with the scope to land the deforestation or the no deforestation with the production of this special farm. And this is what I want to show. How we in Paraguay we were in sustainability production. All the livestock is under grassland farming. Only the three last months we use grains to increase the production before the slaughterhouses, because to send the cows to the slaughterhouses. We seen we need to continue working together. The livestock is part of our culture. We want to increase our food production to feed the world, to complete our commitment to the security, the food global food security. And then they said we want to continue working together with all the countries and organizations that has the same vision about the livestock. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Minister Bertoni, for sharing with us that information about the importance of agriculture for the Paraguayan economy and livelihoods and environment. I think it's really important to be able to show how the farming systems in the region really are, how they're producing, and the complexity in the different public policy instruments you've been working on to balance the productivity, maintenance of forest cover, foreign direct investment, to work on the technical elements, as well as the roundtables for coordinating actors, ensuring the institutional articulation, and of course the finance that you need to really conserve the long-term capital that you have of soils, forests, and the emphasis on smallholder producers. Thank you for sharing that. Now I'd like to pass to hear a little bit the story of Costa Rica, but before that I wanted to give a special welcome to Vice Minister Fernando Vargas, the Vice Minister of Agriculture. From Costa Rica, and giving the presentation will be the Minister of Environment from Costa Rica, Franz Tatenbach. And I think this is a really great example of the leadership Costa Rica is showing in terms of the intersectoral collaboration that we need to really move climate action at the pace and scale we need. So we'd like to hear a little bit about what you've been doing in Costa Rica, Minister Tatenbach.
Thank you very much, Kelly. It will be my pleasure to give a presentation with the permission of the Vice Minister of Agriculture, of course, since we are jointly working on this. And I'm thrilled to do the presentation on behalf of the government of Costa Rica. And basically, the approach here is that Costa Rica has been working for a while in a program to avoid deforestation. This is starting early on in our program, and we have been working this with the farmers, with the private sector, with the forest owners, and we have changed kind of like the balance. We had a program that is very renowned now internationally, the Environmental Service Payment Program. And we have come to a point in which we would like to announce some final achievements in this, which is that we managed to decouple agricultural production from deforestation. But I say that from a country that, and I'm very, very impressed with what Paraguay is doing in the amount of no tillage and all that is impressive that I saw in the presentation, really impressive. 3 million hectares of no tillage and direct seedling. But where we come from is that we have been able to gain and maintain forest cover at the rate of 50%, gain and maintain, which means that we, and at the same time that we lower the emissions from deforestation at the bottom graph. So what we like to call this is that decoupling of agricultural production from deforestation. This is important. This happens not because we abandon our agriculture. Costa Rica is a very strong agricultural export-oriented country. As a matter of fact, we are in per capita basis number one in Latin America in exports per capita of agriculture. So we do export, we do produce, but we have intensified our measures. And as such, we have been able to tell this story. At the top, you have different strategies we have for conservation of forests, which includes everything from national parks and total protection to the environmental service payment in private sector. So we have a complete broad approach to it. Next slide, please. Okay. Now, the new challenges for decarbonization of Costa Rica happen to be in two sectors. Costa Rica has already totally many Latin American countries who have renewable energy resources. We do have renewable energy resources. So our electricity is 100% renewable, 100%. And we have the resources to go times three. So we have the resources to replace all the fossil fuels that are used in the rest of the economy in transportation. So, but that's transportation and electrical energy is their own field. So let's go to the other two sources. The other two sources is landscape. They're agriculture and forestry. We like to put them together now because we can. So we're gonna treat them as a landscape. We have been working this for the country as a whole. The agricultural sector has been part of the whole growing of what we are right now. So we have managed to get enough emissions removals by the forestry sector already certified in a couple of red processes that we have at the stage that we are now happen to be absolutely neutral in our agricultural production emissions. So countrywide, we don't need specific certifications. We need only the UNFCCC methodologies, the ones that we report. So what we report as emissions coming from agriculture and livestock is what we report in the other side as removals. That we believe that is exactly where we would like to move next. And for a reason that is, of course, a little bit self-serving because we will help our trade, but more for a reason because we need and desperately needs to accelerate the implementation of the climate change convention to get to the 1.5 degrees. We believe that we need to move very fast on detaining deforestation. We were signatories of the Glasgow declarations on forests to keep alive the 1.5. I understand that under the Glasgow declarations of forest, one of the instruments that were thought about was international trade, and we intend to take it. And we intend to do our contribution in this regard, because we think that providing this linkage between agricultural production and deforestation, or decoupling, if you wish, is absolutely necessary to accelerate the reduction of emissions and we can treat our country, our smaller 50,000 square meter, we can treat it as a single production unit, and we are in complete balance now. However, why are we doing that? Just like same thing that the Minister of Paraguay mentioned. Our emphasis and adaptation next to in agriculture, we need to adapt agriculture, but how are we going to engage? How are we going to engage the private sector at an early, fast enough with the level of investment that will be required if it is not by providing? We can choose to see the glass half empty or half full. Costa Rica have always chosen to see the glass half full, not half empty. And I'm going to give you an example. When we started dealing with the problem of deforestation, we could have chosen two roads, see the glass half empty and said to those who were deforesting, you are causing tremendous global damage and you are causing by the greenhouse gas emissions that you are providing to humanity. So this global damage, you should be penalized. Okay, that's one approach, and seeing the glass half empty. We choose to see the glass half full. And we say, look, but on the other hand, if you don't deforest them, we can contribute partially toward the cost of not deforesting. So we invented the payment for environmental services. We choose to see the glass half empty. It was a lot easier then to enact the law to forbid deforestation on the back of that big deal. And that big deal came funded by a 1% or 1.5% tax on fossil fuels. Not that much, 25 years ago. 20 years later is that we have achieved the no deforestation and balance between agriculture and how productive an agriculture and extremely productive agriculture. We export $16 billion in agro industry. The enlarged agricultural sector of Costa Rica is $16 billion. It's not showing there, but it's one graph there that has it somewhere, or maybe not. I don't know. But it's that we are number one exporters of pineapple to the world. We're number three in bananas. We're number one in tubers. Export per capita of Latin America, number one. So we have a productive agricultural sector, but we have the challenge. We have the challenge that we have to adapt to climate change. And of course, this productive agricultural sector has to produce less emissions, but we're not gonna penalize it now for the emissions that they have until we can give them some advantage as a country for what we have done together, the forestry sector and the agricultural sector. We have walked this walk together. The agricultural sector has learned to produce more in the same unit of areas. Actually, they gave up 25% of the areas and we're still producing more. There has been a regeneration of about 25% in the country. So this is where we are want to start relating this together, and we're seeing it together. It's for adaptation from one hand to get the engagement of the private sector for the next stage, which is going to be a more adapted agriculture to climate change. And with hopefully with less use of agrochemicals, and the whole sustainability approach is coming. That's a stage three, as you see it there. But we need to give stage one and two at the glass full kind of approach, because the glass half full. Now, having said that, the other reason that we're doing this is because we believe firmly that the best example that we can give for the acceleration of reaching the 1.5 is very fast action in stopping deforestation in the tropical world. And we can do it, we can show it, we have the way to do it. Every country is different. Every country is going to have its own problems. Adaptation is personal, mitigation is global, but adaptation is personal. So we'll go about it with that way. But in phase, we call it phase one, is zero deforestation, forestry, agricultural landscape. We sort of have been reporting it. Second, next one. That's our total profile for the country. The agro, those are the emissions of the consolidated Afolulu and landscape. We are already having a negative one, which should reach, according to our proposals, to 2038 as neutral with the productivity we have. But as soon as we start implementing our NAMAs and our NAPs that are going to be used with this, we're going to launch this to reach the amount of funding that we need to implement our NAMAs and NAPs to become a more adapted country. We expect to continue being neutral in our total landscape. Next one. Okay. Well, those are more like initiatives that we have for, those are internal. So we finished basically our presentation. Thank you for the next lamina, maybe next one. Okay, thank you. Yeah, this is that what we have. That's what we are learning. We have been able to achieve a decoupling of agriculture from emissions. Cattle is included. And this decoupling, I think, is going to give us the impetus and the enthusiasm to the agricultural sector to modernize, adapt to climate change, lower emissions, and build a more sustainable permanent agriculture in our country. And I am thrilled to be making this presentation since a couple of years ago that we're working with the agricultural sector very close, that this is a joint effort with the agricultural sector and myself and the environment, because in Costa Rica, forests are under environment. So I need to clarify this. So forests, national parks and forests are environments, even if they're private, and the rest is agriculture. And so the landscape is necessarily between two ministries. So that is the way it works. Thank you very much, Kelly.
Thank you, Minister, for telling us about that story of how Costa Rica is really decoupling agricultural development from deforestation and now from, you know, net emissions growth, and how that link between forest conservation and farming and this need for this. I mean, it's one thing to start at the farm level, which is complicated enough with all the behavioral change and change in cultural practices that also Minister Bertoni emphasized, that agriculture is inherently a very cultural issue. And so even if we have the technologies, 90% of the solution is working on the social side of things with millions of heterogeneous producers. But this need for a more systemic and integrated landscape approach is where we really need to rise and increase the interinstitutional articulation, and really having the two sectors work together is a critical part of helping Costa Rica to meet its carbon neutrality goals. And not only to meet them, but how do you maintain these changes over time? Because there's always a chance in agriculture, because it's a human activity, that farmers can revert back to practices. And so that constant innovation that we've seen from Costa Rica being so strategic in its use of mitigation actually as a resilience building instrument, and through the two early NAMAs, both in livestock and coffee, and now these more recent ones in rice, musasias, and sugarcane, really showing some great leadership there. So I am going to invite, we have two panelists. Jenny, can you help me bring one more chair up here, please? That are going to speak a little bit after these presentations of these two diverse case studies. So if I can please invite Hillary Hope Fenrich, who is a manager from the international team at the National Wildlife Federation that's been working on this project in Paraguay. And Andrea Perez Valdez, who is the global manager of food systems advocacy for compassion in World Farming International. So hearing these two case studies from both of these countries that have really evolved over time, as we know, change in agriculture is part of the process. What do you see in terms of the scaling up? What do you see in terms of next steps or maybe gaps and things that we need to improve to make sure, again, that these initiatives continue to scale across more hectares and to more producers, and also can keep improving over time to result in more ambitious climate action that also serves to meet food security goals? Maybe we'll start with Hillary.
Sure. Thank you, Kelly. That's a question. First of all, thank you, everyone. Thank you for the space from ICA. Minister, it's a pleasure to be here, Minister, as well. I can't speak too much about Costa Rica other than the gallo pinto that's there, which is delicious. But I will like to take the opportunity to say a little bit. I think across the board, what we see is the need for collaboration. So we know that this is a big goal. This is a big challenge for all of us all over the world, and we need to collaborate in order to bring it together. We're seeing a lot of excellent results already from Paraguay and Costa Rica. And I'd just like to take the moment to talk a little bit about a project that we are working on with the Ministry of Agriculture and Livestock, and aprovechar un poco de este momento. So for those of you that don't know me, I'm Hillary Fenrich from the National Wildlife Federation. We have our base in the United States, but the last 40 years, we've been working outside of the United States, and we are really trying to help in terms of responsible sourcing. So we do this in various ways. So we work to bring international market signals, so the pending regulations that we all know about, to various countries, including Paraguay. We work with local stakeholders to really try to make sure that they understand what sort of commitments they should set, what sort of traceability they should have, how can they be reporting and verifying, and then fixing any issues that come up. So in the last 2 years, we've been working with the ministro and in the MAG, and working to sign a convenio. So we have an agreement since April this year. with the Ministry of Agriculture and Livestock. And under that agreement, we were also able to have an agreement with the National Forestry Institute in Paraguay, which has all of the data in terms of what do producers want to do? Do they want to have a conversion on their land? Are they deforesting? And the ministro was showing an informe, a report that was just recently launched from Infona as well. And what we are really trying to do is look at what is the government data and can we integrate that data between various institutions to make more responsible sourcing decisions, as the ministro was mentioning. And I think that this is something that is based in collaboration, but has a multitude of benefits, not only from Paraguay, but also can serve as a model for other countries. So we know that everyone feels more comfortable taking decisions if they are based in the government official data. We know that the work has saved many, many hours and many thousands of dollars for the various government institutions that we're working with. And we also know that this can really lead and make sure that Paraguay can meet its commitments that it's set out based on its own agenda. So it's all based on what the government has asked for, essentially. And so, again, it's just a pleasure to be here. And I just want to say thank you. Muchas gracias y pura vida.
We've got all the key Costa Rican terms. No, thanks for that. I think collaboration is really key, and also the clear vision that the Ministry of Agriculture in Paraguay is setting then allows other actors to come in. We're not able to meet the sustainability goals for the sector if without this support from, you know, NGOs, the private sector, and other civil society groups. And of course, keeping in mind, I really loved what you said about the minister asking the producers what they need and making sure that these actions respond, because all the risk for this transition can't fall on their backs. Andrea, can you please tell us a little bit of your thoughts?
Thank you. So I'm Andrea Perez Valdez. I'm originally from Peru, and now I work for Compassion World Farming International, which is an animal welfare and environmental NGO. So I'm very happy to be here today. Thank you very much for your presentations. For me, it's very hopeful to hear what you're doing, because precisely what we try to focus is trying to gather case studies as well about agroecology, agroforestry, regenerative agriculture, that in the context of the world that we're living in, it's very important to have those case studies, because many governments around the world actually want to take action to transform our food systems, but in many cases, it's difficult to start from scratch. So if we have case studies from countries that are already being successful and putting a lot of efforts to move towards that direction, is very helpful. In our work, we focus our policy and advocacy efforts to transform our food systems to tackle climate change. And we promote, like I said, regenerative agriculture for animals, people, and our planet. But we also have a focus on just transition, which is we all need to move forward towards more sustainable food systems. But we have to consider, especially in places like in Latin America, that many livelihoods depend on activities like animal agriculture and several types of agriculture. So we want to focus on a fair transition. What are farmers, how farmers are going to come forward? We have to train them. We have to understand that they have their own needs. Also because they are going to be affected by climate change, and they're already affected by climate change. So I'm very happy to hear that there's a big focus on adaptation, because if we don't help farmers adapt to climate change, that's going to threaten food security, and it's going to threaten their productivity and economic welfare. And we have to understand that in places like in Latin America, it's fundamental to bring farmers to the center of policy decisions. And I also feel like it's very important to bring the private sector and NGOs like us, because we can bring different perspectives and we can work together. Because at the end of the day, what we want to do is feed a growing population without affecting our planet.
Thanks so much for that, Andrea. It's certainly true and echoes what Minister Tettenbach was saying about how mitigation benefits are really global. And if, you know, mitigation in and of itself doesn't provide a benefit for farmers unless there's co-benefits of enhanced efficiency and competitiveness, and it enables them to help feed their families and produce well. I'd like to turn for a minute back to the ministers. We're here at the COP27. It's a really big platform. This is the first year that agriculture has and food systems have really been more central to the discussion, both in the formal negotiations through Porto Nivea, as well as through side events, official side events, and Agriculture and Adaptation Day. But given the work that you've been doing, what is the key message that you want people to know about agriculture and its link to climate change in your country?
Okay. Well, I think that it is necessary really to start walking this. How are we going to get there? We know we have to get to zero emissions. We got to get net neutral or net zero, whatever it is called, by 2050. We know how more or less it's going to work in the energy sector and in the landscape, and the landscape has to work more or less the same way. So we got to get there. We would like to, the challenge is to see it together. And I think, like you said, it is we need to weigh very careful the global benefits of mitigation with the needs of adaptation. They're not gonna come for free. Adaptation is gonna be, I see it's gonna be hard. It's a hard proposal. I think we need to also deal with a little bit more insurance-like type of thing, which is the loss and damages. I think the approach has to be refined there. I was very encouraged by, I think the German launched the global shield, I think they call it today, to deal with loss and damages, which is interesting. We're being hit very badly. Costa Rica got hit this year very badly by climate change events. We had to borrow from the IMF $700 million to deal with the impact of climate change or hydrometeorological events. This year and last year, $1.5 billion already of impact. It's setting us back. It's setting us back in our development. It's hitting the population. It's not hitting, it's hitting the whole population, it's hitting our agricultural, our infrastructure in the schooling, it's hitting our roads, it's hitting agriculture. Yeah, it's bad, it has to be treated as an insurance, I think. I mean, I know that the agricultural sector has been kind of positioning these topics of insurance, and it's important that we be taken as part of is a measure of adaptation. If you wish to have a global system working for insurance against climate events, and at the same time making your resilient agricultural system, we depend on that. Not maybe as much as Paraguay, but Costa Rica still has 24% of its GDP depending on agro industry. I mean, the whole agriculture as a whole is still 25% of its GDP is agro industry. And it has been growing and employs probably a higher proportion to the rest of the economy. So it is a very important thing that this is taken urgently and serious. Urgently, the reduction of emissions. I think dealing with agricultural emissions, especially as it relates to deforestation, or maybe there are other ones, or land degradation, could bring, I don't call it low-hanging fruit, that's a horrible term. I think the term should be efficient way of dealing with something that is urgent. When something is urgent, you go for the efficient. What is it that is not urgent to deal with emissions? If it is urgent, we go for the efficient and go fast and move fast on the efficient, because we're not getting there. I mean, the pledges of NDCs are getting into, sorry, I'm getting a little bit negotiating here, but the pledges of the NDC are getting us to 1.7. degrees, but the actions are getting us 2.8. So where are we? Still, are we worried that we have to be more ambitious in the pledges and not on the action? No, I think the proof is on the action now. And I think linking agriculture to deforestation, the whole landscape approach, or bringing agriculture full blown into the climate change mitigation fast, dealing with the what the US launched the other day, the methane. I think is wonderful. This methane initiative launched by President Biden, I think at the couple of days ago. I think it's wonderful because these things are accelerators to get to the 1.5. I mean, we're going a little bit slow in the other road. Let's get some acceleration. So that's what we saw as an opportunity globally and locally to adapt. So that's my reflection.
Well, first, we celebrate that the agricultural issues now are a main issue in this discussion about the climate change, because in the past it doesn't happen that, and that it has become a grain concern for countries like Paraguay. When the agricultural sector is very important for us, when we start in the 2000, since the year before the pandemic, Paraguay can reduce the poverty index in 50%, sense and the behavior of the agricultural sectors. And then it's because we are very concerned about the result of this discussion, what kind of commitment we can assume of this climate change discussion, but it's because we are here looking what's happened, what can be. Then we celebrate also this type of discussion when the landscape vision about the agriculture can help to show the world how the agricultural sector is working in Latin America in sustainable matters. Working to carbon zero production, but to reach that we need cooperation, mainly in technical cooperation, to develop our metric system to show the real balance. For example, when we the count has emission, but when we put the count in the grass in a grassland farming system, the balance probably is zero. The agricultural is the only sector that had the capability to sequester carbon sequestration, and that is the reason because we always say that the agriculture is not the problem, but it's a part of the solution. Thank you very much.
Yeah, great point about the need, the necessity of stronger MRV and monitoring evaluation systems so that we know that the actions we're taking and planning for are actually getting us to the point where we want to be, which is this 1.5 degree goal, especially given the climate vulnerability of the sector. So I want to turn back really quickly to Hillary and Andrea. You know, we know that especially when we're looking at low emission food exports, we have to think about consumer decisions. We have to think about food prices, especially at a time like now where, you know, prices are very high, labels, competitiveness. What do you see? Where do you see there's room for improvement in the actions that have been taking? What have we not been getting exactly right? And you think we can change to make sure that these visions that the countries have can really be for low emissions food product development really be realized? Another very easy question.
Yes, so I think the consumption part is very important actually, because it can be difficult to compete if it's a product that has low emissions with other products that have not the same quality, for example, but are cheaper. So how can you compete in a market where other countries, for example, don't give the same quality that you're trying to bring, and bringing all these efforts together, if at the end of the day, consumers are going to prefer going for the cheaper option, which is understandable because people have to eat. And of course, we're going through difficult times at the moment in the world. But I think it's fundamental to bring your experiences, like I said, to countries, for example, that have higher emissions. Because at the end of the day, if those countries that are high emitters don't bring the same measure that you're trying to bring, it's going to be difficult to compete in an environment like that, because not all consumers have the possibility to choose products with lower emissions. That's what I wanted to say.
Thank you, Andrea. I want to say something that might not be very popular, but I don't believe that consumers saying, I want to buy this or I want to buy that makes the difference. And I think there's many facets of that. At the end of the day, for instance, we know Paraguayan beef is almost exclusively grass-fed, which is fantastic. But I don't see a label on that. When I go to the grocery store in the United States, I am looking potentially for a grass-fed piece of meat, but it's not necessarily a Paraguayan Chaco beef that I see. So I think we are losing folks by asking for certifications sometimes when you can have beef that is highly sustainable, but it doesn't have that label on it. And I also would encourage consumers, if they're looking to make these decisions, to be asking the right questions. So oftentimes we put the pressure on consumers when really, if you think about the supply chain, it's not the consumers that should receive that pressure. So if consumers care about sustainable beef, they should be calling up their supermarkets. They should be calling up their government. They should be saying, what are you doing to make sure that this agriculture is sustainable? Because agriculture can be sustainable. Just like the ministro was saying, it can be the solution. It can sequester carbon. And we should remember that, rather than trying to just put it to the side. So I don't know if that's popular, but that's what I believe.
It's great to hear all perspectives here as we move forward. Well, we're about out of time, but I wanted to give everyone a chance for one final message, perhaps something forward-looking about your next step in helping move towards low emissions food systems and this really, you know, at a landscape scale. How do we move beyond the farm to think about the broader system? And I'll start with Andrea.
Yeah, so I think that more support from the private sector has to be done. I think it's very important to engage with the private sector to move forward. And I really like the word that decoupling agriculture from deforestation. I think that's very important because I've been engaged in many discussions in COP27 talking about the relationship between forestation, deforestation and animal agriculture. That yes, it's linked, but if we start with this phrase that decoupling animal agriculture from deforestation and we bring what Costa Rica is doing to the world, is actually we can have hope and we can feel better that we can move forward. So in my minute, I would like to propose that maybe we continue sharing case studies, and perhaps 1 year from now, we can get together again and talk about the progress, and perhaps also bring other countries in Latin America that want to learn from your experiences and don't know exactly how to do it. I think that would be great.
Thank you, Andrea. For my minute, I have 2 points, which is, first of all, the importance of data. So at the COP, we hear all about our commitments, our global commitments, our local commitments, what we're promising the world, how much money we're putting towards it. And that is all great. But at the end of the day, a commitment is only the very first piece. And so what do you need to do to actually have implementation? And I think underneath all of that, you need data, which is exactly what both ministers were saying, that we need to understand really what's happening on the ground. And I think both in Paraguay and Costa Rica, there's a rich base of data already. And so let's be looking at that. Let's understand where the gaps are. And I think important piece of implementation is once you have that data, it's not enough. So you can kind of look and see how you're doing on the progress, but then you need to look at the next step and say, oh, there are some issues here. How are you going to fix those issues? And I think that's an important piece of the process as well. And then the last piece is financial incentives. So we like to talk a lot about the millions of dollars that are promised at COP. How are those making it into the hands of producers who are producing the food that we eat every single day? What does that look like? And how do we make sure that the money actually goes to them if they're having more sustainable practices? Thank you.
Fantastic. Yeah, we heard that statistic the other day that less than 5% of the climate finance going to agriculture is actually making it down to the farmers. Minister Bertoni, one final message.
Well, I want to say they completely agreed with Andrea, but we must engage all the sector, especially the private sector, the farmers in this discussion, because they are the probably the most affected in the climate change, and they can help us in find their solution for this problem. All the message is we want to look scientific solution for this problem, because to have the focus in the science can help us how we can deal with this problem, the climate change, the resilience, and how become more sustainable production to increase our economy and also for to feed the world. Thank you.
Yes, agree with both panelists. I mean, data is very important, but we have our data. We think data should be official. It should be the one that is submitted to the UNFCCC CCC. I mean, and the thing that we talk about, I mean, that's the data we like to use so that there is no greenwashing or double counting or things like that. On the other hand, I believe in all the other initiatives that have to be packages at the beginning to launch something. I mean, we were there when we were launching our forestry sector. Regarding consumer or no consumer, I think it's an interesting perspective. And yeah, I agree with you. I think that the labels are dangerous. That's why we are going more for trade. But because we believe in a more comprehensive global governance about this. And prices, yeah, it could be at the beginning. I mean, you need all the approaches. Situation is so urgent that I would not like to be cynical about any approach being taken in order to, I think if you say you're doing something good, I think you are doing something good probably. So that's my first approach. And then, but once you move it to more serious and to markets, I think you have to become more, you have to be looked at a little bit deeper. But yeah, I think each country also has to walk its own way. We started working some time ago, and now we're seeing already challenges. We're seeing the challenge of our tax base on fossil fuels going to be dwindling because we are moving to an electrical economy now and renewable. So we cannot finance or things with that. And so those are different challenges. In the long run, implementation has an urgent. And I think we cannot, maybe I share a little bit of experience from forestry. We debated for too long perfect data. I don't think you should debate for too long perfect data. Carry on with a plus minus 20% margin of error, but carry on. I mean, because there are two different things. Science have to progress. Scientists like to progress more. They like to learn more. They like to learn better. New approaches are going to come. But we cannot freeze action because we don't have sufficient information. So my recommendation for agriculture is do the best. Do with the best of the science you have now, and then perfect.
Thank you very much to all of our panelists today, and for GASL for sponsoring this session, and as well as to Mauricio Chacon for organizing this really interesting discussion. I think a lot of important points came out, the importance of taking as a starting point the national circumstances. We heard a lot about different pathways. We can't duplicate, but we can learn from each other, and thus the importance of learning from these case studies to make sure that they reflect the needs of our rural areas and producers, the importance of having a longer term vision, which can be difficult in agriculture, which faces many day-to-day challenges, And the need for a landscape perspective. How do we care for the farms and the farmers? At the same time, we think more broadly about the ecosystem services and the conditions we need to put in place so they have the long-term natural capital to continue feeding the world. The importance of data, we don't need perfect data, but we need to work with what we have as we collect more. The need to better involve the private sector so we get the investment at the scale we need and we can get to more farmers and more hectares. And really, I think this shows the importance of the ministries of agriculture getting more involved in the international climate agenda, where they're really setting the conditions to enable action at the national level. And this is really what we're talking about with Coronavia, is the means of implementation. And this is where national action links into the international processes. We at ICA are very committed to helping the countries navigate this challenging path to continue to bring actors, public and private, together. And again, thank you so much to Minister Tattenbeck, Minister Bertoni, and to Hillary and Andrea for sharing your perspectives with us today. And thanks to all of you for listening.